Nighttime on Still Waters. This is NB506812, narrowcasting into the night from somewhere on Britain's waterways. May 31st, Friday. Standing looking southwest across the vale. Four ducks circle above the water, then swoop down and land in unison. The fields and hills in the distance fade into soft light. Tonight, the sky is almost clear, and the moon has several more hours before it rises. And although the twilight deepens, there's still a steely light that picks out the skimming and fluster of bats and the flicker of insect wings. The wind is slowly abating, and the reeds and rushes stand quiet and still. Only the shimmer of alder, mirrored by the canal surface, is proof that this is not a painted scene. And this is the narrowboat Erica, narrowcasting into the calm night skies of Warwickshire, to you, wherever you are. You made it. I'm so glad that you could come. And it's a lovely night tonight. The stars are beginning to slowly appear through the thin, gauzy haze. It's a good night to just kick back, rest a while, breathe in deeply the scent of sleeping vegetation and still waters. And the kettle and biscuit barrel are waiting for you, so step inside, welcome aboard. These are the kind of days I love. Days of profligate greens and blues and, yes, sometimes even greys. The piling tumble of clouds, heaped high, like ice cream cones when we were kids and when ice lollies came with little cards that you could collect, but probably never did. And all along the towpath, the serious growth is underway. The soft green matting of the crawling ivy and goosegrass, of those far-off, damp and chill early spring days. Remember them? And now overrun by thick nettle, avens, campion and mallow. But even these are now being dwarfed by the late spring big hitters, cow parsley, water hemlock, and the greatest beast of them all, giant hogweed, with its thick-ribbed, sow-bristled stem. The plant the tabloids love to hate. Each year they evoke apoplectic warnings to everyone foolish enough to emerge blinking from the castles of their houses that protect them from all the peril of a world beyond the concrete and the pavement, to enjoy a bit of fresh air. And although it's more diminutive but truly lethal cousin, the water hemlock, has as yet, for the most part, escaped their frenzied attention. But I love the unapologetic way of hogweeds. They are there, with no bye or leave, thank you very much, creamy white parasols, held open by broad green ribs. We, as a people, may have taken against them, but their closer colonies and communities prize them well. In the heat of summer, their shade keeps the ground cover damp and green. There's one beside the nearest bridge here. Herb Robert, dwarfed and outgrown, clings up the bristly stem. The old Native American plant lore unfolding. Where there is the threat of harm, look to find the promise of healing. And Vetch too is riding high, surfing the arching green waves of early summer growth along the banksides and hedgerows. Rich, warm mauve and purple studs pointillist-like stabs of colour among the thick swathes of green. And the elder blossom is now falling in snowflakes that smell sweet of summer heat and wine. And the towpath and canal surface are confetted with sweeps of tiny star-shaped petals. Scrawny new embankments are lit with the lunar glow of oxeye daisies, large moonish buttons of white and gold. Unlike the smaller daisy, oxeyes do not close at night, and so each night the banks glow with a spectral wash of entrancing floral moonshine. And the grasses are now growing tall upon the hill above us, and the owl-chapeled oak that nestles in its bole has its tonsured ruff of green foliage, small, tight, green leaves haloing the gnarled twist of branches. This is the only growth left for it. A snaggled hag-twist of arthritic claw-like limbs, ancient and crow-loved. Older than time, or at least older than my time, which is perhaps, after all, the same thing. And it's going through the same thing that Dad went through in his final days. The quiet, slow shutting down. First the peripheries, then the core. The slowing of xylem and phloem flow into the welcome of the last deep sleep. But before then, the rooks stand on its topmost branches, and starlings cluster and squabble and swarm, and around its roots the new diggings of rabbit and badger. Death and dying in this world are not like that found in our worlds. Or perhaps I'm learning that actually, if we have eyes to see, they are not so dissimilar. And on these days, on this hill, the wind rakes her finger through the silvery feathers of brome and fescues and rye, making the grasses shiver and ripple in running waves across the fields, just like the waters of the canal in the valley below. And tight knots of hawksbeard are here, rivaling dandelions and buttercup and clover, and yellow carpets of hop-like black medic. Yes, these are the kind of days I love. They're the sort of welcoming, inviting days. Days that call out to you to join them, to be part of this buzzing, singing, whirlpool of colour type of day. On days like these, the canal is also so inviting. I'm not in a come and dive into me for a swim type of inviting. No, the thick olive and taupe ribbon of water glistens and shimmers, catching the shy light filtering through the heavy arms of ash. Come, follow me, it seems to call. There are places I have yet to show you. Follow me around the next bend, and then the next, and perhaps even the next and beyond. And on these days, it is so very difficult not to just start the engine, untie the mooring ropes, and follow this siren song. And is this impulse what the migrating birds feel? This itch, the sudden longing to meet a new horizon that is both familiar and yet new? Yes, old friend. Soon, soon we will follow your watery way among the reeds and wood havens, beneath canopies of oak and ash, alder and poplar. We will follow you to the next bend, and then the next, and then perhaps even the next. and beyond. It's lovely to be here, a small pool of oasis calm amid the noise and fury of life at the moment. We are getting there, and thank you to everyone who has taken time to contact me to find out how things are going. Yeah, it's busy, and there's a little time to spare at the moment, but it's not overwhelming now. In fact, last weekend we took a much-needed breather away from sorting through Dad's house and work, and we all went to Crick Boat Show, Wendy, my sister, included. And it was just good to be away from things. There are quite a few boat shows now, and some of the newer ones appear to be vying for the crown, but I think, and I might be upsetting a few people here, as far as canals and canal boats are concerned, Crick Boat Show is still probably the biggest and the most popular. And it's the first time we actually made it. Twice we've had tickets, but each time something cropped up and we had to cancel and give them away. And when we booked up last year, Wendy said that she'd also like to come with us. The joke was, well, what's going to happen this year to stop us going? And then Dad got sick. It's busy, loud, and incredibly crowded. Really all the things that I find rather uncomfortable and would naturally keep away from. But it was also lovely. Lovely to feel the energy and excitement, the hustle and bustle, and to see such a wide range of people. Canals attract the attention and love of such a diversity of people. Old enthusiasts, pedantic in terminology, retired professionals, young families, the hippie and the bohemians, the weekenders, the liverboards, the experts, the novices, the nervous newbies, the old hands, the idealists, the cynical, the young and the old, all getting along, sharing news, ideas, dreams, past and future. And it was great to catch up with two of our regular listeners and supporters there, Derek and Pauline Watts from the narrowboat Silver Fox. Derek was there having his beard shaved for charity with Gary Phillips from the narrowboat Chuggabug. And together they raised over £4,000 for cancer research. So well done, both of you. And it was so great to meet up with you at last. And yes, we did manage to get the fridge installed. And it fitted. The freezer compartment of our fridge broke the first winter that we were aboard. And since then, it's limped through the subsequent 3.5 odd years, either acting as an ice box, literally a box full of ice, or an expensive, tepidly cool cupboard. We kept promising ourselves to get a new one, but time and expense meant that it kept slipping down the priorities. And this year, we decided that the fridge wasn't going to last much longer and that we really needed to do something about it. There's always some good show offers on at Crick, and so with measurements and bated breath, we took the plunge. It's always a bit of a risk, as with a narrowboat, you never quite know what you're going to find when you take something that's been part of the boat since it was built out. It was very messy, very physical. All went well, and it's now there, installed, and working well. Fingers crossed. A couple of weeks ago, Kevin B. from Mastodon contacted me, and thank you, Kevin, for letting me know about the adverts that are being added. I'm aware that a number of the podcast directories and players are now beginning to add adverts to the podcasts. I think partly to monetize them, to cover their own running costs, but also it seems, I think, to tempt people into paying for a subscription for ad-free content. And I'm not sure which ones are doing this. It's not always easy to tell which adverts have been added by the podcaster themselves or by a third party, like the directories. However, if while you're listening, you do get some adverts, then please know that I have not added them and I am not planning to add them. So if you are hearing adverts on this podcast, these have been added by a third party and nothing to do with me, and I'm getting no revenue from it. And if you are finding them intrusive, then I'd encourage you to try another directory, or better still, use the player on our website at noswpod.com. And talking about people getting in contact, it was lovely to hear from you, Captain Arlo. Thank you so much for sending me those photographs. And yes, I think your dad and mine would certainly have had a lot to chat and laugh about. And I'm also delighted to give a very special greeting to a couple of new listeners. Hello and welcome to Deborah Vass. I'm so glad that you found us and have been enjoying the podcast. And thank you so much for taking the time and trouble to contact me and spread the word of Nighttime on Still Waters on your Substack post. As I wrote to you earlier, your artwork is wonderful, and your site, Still Sketching, is a work of art in itself, and a much-needed peaceful haven of tranquility and beauty. And hello also to Kelly Conway, and thank you so much for joining us, and I'm so pleased that you like these podcasts. Kelly is another exceptionally talented artist who crafts some beautifully intricate nature-inspired lino cuts. And I'm going to put the links to both Kelly and Deborah's websites on the website program notes for this episode, because they tend to be a little bit fuller and I'm not restricted with word counts. So if you would like to see either Deborah or Kelly's work, then go along to noswpod.com. and look at this episode's program notes. Hello also to Jason and Karen, who featured in the previous episode. They've now posted a couple of lovely videos on their Just Two People YouTube channel of their first trip on the narrowboat on the Leeds and Liverpool Canal. And it came in just too late to mention them in the last podcast, but the links are in the program notes, and they are really well worth a look at. And hello also to Lee over in Colorado. I've been loving the wildlife videos, Lee, so thank you. And back over on Mastodon, hello to Anna McKellar. And on Instagram and Facebook, hello to Perry Coleman. Perry, I just love the idea that while I'm here in the UK talking to you, over there, you're quietly at your spinning wheel, hot milk beside you, and listening to these words as they come to you through our shared darkness of our night times, even across the globe. That's wonderful. And also hello to Sherry Rauch, and to Karen Smith, and to Tracy Thomas, and Rosario Aquara Martin, and of course to LJ and Bodie. And thank you all for your comments on the Swan posts. And Maggie's really enjoying the warmer and drier weather, Bodie. I hope you are too. And also hello to Deb Moon Mountford. It's good to hear from you, Deb, and I hope all is well with you in your neck of the woods. And it was also really wonderful to welcome a new member to our growing band of Lockwheelers. Thank you all so much for your support and for your patience over the rather sporadic podcast so far this year. So welcome to David Dirom. And David, I hope I've pronounced your surname correctly. I'm guessing, David, that you're from Canada. And anyway, welcome aboard and thank you. So thank you to all of our Lockwheelers. They are David Dirom, Chris and Alan on the narrowboat, The Land of Green Ginger, Captain Arlo, Rebecca Russell, Allison on the narrowboat, Mukka, Derek and Pauline on Silver Fox, Anna V, Orange Cookie, Donna Kelly, Mary Keane, Tony Rutherford, Arabella Holzapfel, Rory with MJ and Kayla, Narrowboat Precious Jet, Linda Reynolds Birkins, Richard Noble, Carol Ferguson, Tracy Thomas, Mark and Tricia Stowe, and Madeline Smith. Thank you. Sometimes episodes can just take over and form their own shapes and follow their own paths, and I'm thinking that this one is doing exactly that. I did have in mind a planned topic for this episode, but then the arrival of a bunch of cygnets on the moorings meant that I dropped that idea and planned to do something on them instead. And actually, when I sat down to do this, that's exactly what I had in mind. And also to answer a question that Lee had sent me a few months back about the swans. However, I'm just running out of time, both prep and recording time. So really, this is, I guess, turning out to be just a catch-up type of episode. And so I'll just say that the swans were successful in their nesting and laying this year. And I know I mentioned a couple of episodes back that they had built a nest. And I think at that time I'd noticed one or two eggs having been laid. Well, seven cygnets have arrived. And of course, interest and excitement in the locality is huge. And I'm going to give you much more of an update and information about it, as well as answering your question, Lee, in the next episode. I promise. Actually, being so busy and being away such a lot, as well as having just to work on the boat, has been quite good. It's actually also been good to use my hands again, to practically become part of the boat and this whole life once more. To watch the jobs being ticked off the list, to get on top of things rather than for them to feel like they're getting on top of us. There's a long, long way to go yet, but we're making progress. And the Erica is beginning to feel part of us once more, rather than being this long tube-like room to drop dirty clothes on and a place just to sleep and work and then off again. I don't think either of us actually felt that she wasn't part of us, but earlier today, as I was clearing out a winter's worth of dust and grit from beneath the stove and sorting through piles and piles of accumulated papers, the sun shone up from the water's surface, dancing patterns on the oak ceiling of the cabin. And I thought, I'm back. And I hadn't realized that I had been away. But I am back. And all of this busyness has meant that while I have not been able to record as much or as often as I have wanted, and I do miss it, it has also meant that I haven't even had the headspace to work on episode topics or even just to write, and that's always the first stage of each podcast. But it has given me the gift of distance, and that's meant that I've got a lot of ideas bouncing around my head. For the podcast, but also other related things. And I'm hoping that by middle to late June, and I have my fingers crossed here, that I can once again get into a more regular pattern again. I have a lot of things to share, and there are a lot of things that I want to know about the world, but also about you. And I want to explore them. And I want to explore them with you. And while I've been away, one of the things that struck me has been that I've not really been able to do much recording of soundscapes or really include them within the podcasts. And last weekend when we were staying with Wendy up in Northamptonshire, John Clare's country, I determined to put that right. I'd not planned this, but wow, why not? On Sunday morning, last Sunday morning, Maggie and I went for a walk in a local wooded park. It's beautiful. A landscape of skylark and kestrel. And a soft rain was falling in the silver light of a morning in late May. It was early. There were only a few of us dog walkers out there. and they tended to be with dogs who preferred not to socialize, so they all participated in that unspoken, unbidden but necessary waltz of finding routes around each other to maintain that social distance. It suited me, if not Maggie. And a couple of rabbits scurried through the long growth of one of the rides. But all else was still, apart from the rain and the rustle of leaf shimmer. And that stillness you get on a Sunday morning. The stillness of a deep breath being taken. And all around, birdsong. Deep and more richly layered than I've heard for a long time. And for a while, we stood beside the shallow river that runs along one edge of the park. The trees come down almost to the water's edge. Before slowly we made our way up the hill to the sound of a distant church bell striking 7 o'clock. And I mentioned that this was John Clare country, or at least on the doorstep of it. And although his poem Daybreak captures a sunnier dawn rather than this gentle rainy one, I cannot think of a better way to finish tonight than by reading it, as we listen to the song of the morning on a Sunday in May, in the company of blackbird, robin, thrush, wood pigeon, wren, dunnock, greenfinch, goldcrest, collared dove, blue tit. But first, a few lines from his shepherd's calendar. The brook resumes its summer dresses, purling with grass and watercresses, and mint and flagley soaring high their blooms to the unheeding eye, and taper bow-bent hanging rushes, and horsetail children's bottle brushes, and summer tracks about its brink is fresh again, where cattle drink. The red east glows. The dewy cheek of day has not yet met the sun's o'erpowering smile. The dewdrops in their beauty still are gay, save those the shepherd's early steps defile. Pleased will I linger o'er the scene a while. The black clouds melt away, the larks awaken. Sing, rising bird, and I will join with thee. If daybreak's beauties, I have been taken. As thy first anthem breathed its melody, I stood and paused the very cloud to see, and warmed in ecstasy, and looked and warmed when day's first rays, the far hilltop adorning, fringed the blue clouds with gold. Oh, doubly charmed, I hung in raptures then on early morning. This is the Narrowboat Erica, signing off for the night and wishing you a very restful and peaceful night. Good night. Temperature, outside. 13.7 degrees. Inside. 22 degrees. Humidity. 72%. Dew point. 9 degrees. Wind direction. North-northeast. Wind strength. 6 miles per hour. Barometric pressure. 1027.8. Rising. Cloud cover. 3%. Cloud ceiling. None. Precipitation. Nil. Moon phase. 25.5%. Waning crescent. Day length. 16 hours, 28 minutes. Sunset. 21:20. Sky casting. 4:50.